with our 4 o'clock council work session. Madam Clerk, it's your report, please.
Yes, Ms. Cole, Mr. Jones, Mr. Schmidt.
Here.
Mr. Lynn.
Here.
Mr. Morrissey.
Here.
Mr. Walper.
Here.
Mr. Hart.
Here. Motion to approve the agenda.
Second.
All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion carries. Guys, we're here today. The Human Rights Commission has asked to give us a presentation on the, quote, ban the box issue, which is becoming nationally prominent. And Abraham, it's yours.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for the time today, by the way. And to the city councilman, I just want you to know that we did put a packet at your desk. You probably received a black folder as well, but additional information that we put at your desk today is very, very relevant to what we're talking about today. I just want to begin to let you know that I'll speak a little bit, and then we're going to invite our council chair, should I say our commission chair, to come forward and share his perspective as well as a former human resource professional at Tyson Foods. But I'll begin. As the letter indicates, we are happy to report that since first coming to you all about 3 years ago, we have now a lot of information that speaks to the benefits associated with fair hiring policy within communities. And additionally to fair hiring, we also want you to think about this in terms of landlords too, and rental applications for those who are looking for housing. But the fact remains is that a lot of our returning citizens, as demonstrated by the work of Michelle Alexander, have a very difficult time returning to community and being able to really get readjusted because they can't get work or they can't find decent housing, and they can't do a host of other things as a result of the felony in their background. And so now research is showing us that when we take proactive, concerted steps in order to try to take into consideration the plight of these individuals in our community, we can make a difference, and it improves the community all the way around, economically and socially, improving the quality of life for everyone. And so if you would just look at this with me for a second, I want to invite you to turn in your packet to the back and look at page 39. When we first came about 3 years ago, we didn't have that much data because we were really trying to be proactive, and we stepped out there with the hope that we would begin the conversation in earnest about doing something that would benefit those who fell into this class, if you will. And now we've got national research data that supports the fair housing, the ban the box policy, or the fair chance policies. And as you can see, I just want to walk you through them and just direct your attention to them as we move through this very, very quickly. Obviously, I know you will take your time and read through it as well. But one, the data now supports that removing job barriers for people with records helps the economy. And so that's a really good thing in light of all of the other great development that's happening in the city of Waterloo. We could use additional taxpayers in the city of Waterloo. B, it also improves public safety, which I think is also very big here in Blackhawk County, big in Waterloo. If we can cut down on recidivism by ensuring that people have opportunities at least to get a fair shake at getting a good job, we are amazed at even how 30 days of employment does much to cut into the recidivism rate. And so I certainly want you to pay attention to that point. Children and families suffer when people with records can't work, so we can make it easier for them to get employment and housing, for that matter. That's good. And then you can look at the others there. I will just invite you to look at that, but I do want to bring your attention just before I leave. I don't want to dominate your time. I wanted to also bring your attention to these two sheets, the color sheets that I put at your desk. Some of the questions that might ordinarily come up, if you look at the orange sheet first, community hiring model language, if you turn on the back, we know that banning the box obviously reduced the stigma associated with having criminal arrest in one's background. Banning the box obviously is an experiment that has proven successful, and these are some of the measures and practices on the back of the page that I think you would be very, very interested in. And so I encourage you to look at those. A background check may be unnecessary for some jobs, and if a background check is necessary, only consider those convictions with a direct relationship to job responsibilities. That has come up before, some 3 years ago, and all in between. Those kinds of questions come up. The point with ban the box is that we're delaying the idea of learning about one's criminal record. Just to be clear, it doesn't stop an employer from doing background checks. That's still necessary, and nobody's challenging that at all. You still have to do drug tests. That's still necessary. Nobody's challenging that at all. And depending on the jobs and the more turpitude clauses and that kind of thing, one's background probably has everything to do with the job that they're applying for. So we're not talking about those kinds of things either. What we are talking about is an example of someone who actually came to our office once complaining that he didn't get a job, although we didn't find evidence to support his overall claim. But he came because he said at 40 years of age, he was being held accountable for something that happened at 19 years of age. And we're saying that EEOC as of 2012 and all of this other new data that's coming forward by the National Employment Law Project, they're showing that we are still penalizing individuals with criminal arrest in their background, even though the offense in question may have taken place at some time when they were still very, very young, and they've matured a whole lot since then, as is in the case of the gentleman I just described. He's 40, but still being held accountable for something he did at 19. And then, of course, we want to force employers and landlords, for that matter, to take into consideration a case-by-case approach. We want them to do an individualized assessment of each of the people that they may have to reckon with. Because what we find sometimes is that you may have a very qualified individual in front of you, but the tendency as of now, without this kind of protection in place, is to just dismiss an applicant because they've got a felony in their background. By banning the box or by employing fair hiring practices, the employer is then forced to at least do the interview on an individualized manner, find out if they're qualified, and then when you begin to do the criminal background check, you may determine that this person has done a lot of professional work since the offense. They may have gotten professional certifications. They can provide you with all kinds of recommendations from reliable, reputable individuals in the community as to how they have changed. We may learn that the felony itself is now 7, 8, 9, 10 years old. We may find that the felony has absolutely nothing to do with the job that they're applying for, and so forth and so on. And so now we've got people from all ideological backgrounds saying that, you know what, we should not penalize people on flimsy evidence, such as maybe some section of their life when they did drugs or something. And it has absolutely no bearing on the job that they're doing today. And so, again, we come to you now and just simply saying that we think that now the data suggests that it's time. It's time that we begin to really explore this fully, very carefully. We've got a lot of research data that shows the benefits of it and the information that I spelled out to you. On the pink sheet that Councilman Lynn is looking at right now, we've got even quotes from other leaders in community across this nation that can attest to the benefits of eradicating employment discrimination and that kind of thing. And so we just encourage you to look over that very carefully as we begin to deliberate and consider seriously the idea of a ban the box policy for the city of Waterloo. We believe it can work, and we believe now is the time. If you will, I want to invite now Ron Wood. He's our commission chair.
First of all, Ron Wood, commission chair. No numbers there. Gosh, I'm excited. I want to talk a little bit from my professional career as an HR professional with Tyson Foods. Our application did have a place to mark if you were a felon or not, but it was optional. You did not have to do it if you did not want to. So what we did in our meetings and as we went forward, it was explained to us and it made perfect sense to me that first of all, as an employer, you have to follow the law. And part of the law, if you take that application and say, oh, it's a felony, and throw it in the file 19, that is not, it is something you can't do. You have to take a look at it. First of all, if you only need three people, there's no use taking 100 applications. Just trying to give you a little bit of the background. So we were very careful about that to try to do it. Once they did it, I looked at it. There were certain things we looked at. Had they worked at Tyson before? And that was one of our policies. And a lot of times we hired for a specific job. So sometimes those didn't fit. So what happens is, and the big employers, Target has banned the box. John Deere doesn't look at it as hard as they used to. I can't say 100%. Tyson has, really gone back on that type of things. It's a lot of the small employers in town that actually violate the law. And I don't think they do it meanly or anything like that, but they just don't know. So by putting a ban in the box in would actually protect a lot of employers from possible litigation, possible EEOC type charges against them. The second part I want to make as an HR professional, I had a lot of people come in and they had the box marked. Didn't ever stop me. They came in, I asked them what it was, and I always kiddingly said, as long as you didn't shoot the HR manager, we can talk, You can get a chuckle out of you guys. Unfortunately, a lot of people think, okay, it's a felon. They're gonna do bad things. That's not always the case. You would be shocked at how many people that came in asked me, Ron, how do I get ahead? Pretty simple. Come to work, do what you need to do, do your job, all those kind of things. And I've had a lot of them. I had at least three that I can tell you that are at a corporate level now. And they have felonies against them. One of the things, when you look at a felony, back to what Director Funch said, you got to look what it was. If it was, I had possession of marijuana when I was 19 years old, you're 40 years old now, and you're still against you, does he still smoke or she still smoke marijuana? I don't know. But the bottom line is they paid their dues for what they've done. Now we need to give those individuals an opportunity to get back into the workforce, to become an integral part of our workforce. So from an HR professional, I think this is one of the greatest things we can do. From economics, I was looking at some of the individuals that back at Governor Christie, Governor Rand Paul, they went on and on and on about that it does help the economy and it is beneficial. So I appreciate you listening to me, and if you have any questions, I would surely field those in a minute.
All right, I do, Ron, or Abram. I'm not sure if that's the end of your presentation or not, but for whoever can answer, what are you asking the city or the city council specifically to do, Abraham? Are you asking us to pass an ordinance that would require all employers in the city of Waterloo to, quote, ban the box? Or are you asking the council to pass a policy for the city to ban the box on their applications?
Right, good question. No, we're hoping that city council would consider passing an ordinance that will hold public and private employers responsible to engage in fair hiring policy, as well as for landlords, market landlords. We were successful in February 2014 to pass a domestic violence ordinance that protected specifically women and children from being put out of a home as a result of domestic violence, sexual assault, and that applied to market landlords. And what we're asking specifically for in this case is that the city would pass an ordinance. Interestingly enough, we have some sample ordinance language in here, and we have been talking to Chris Windman in particular. But an ordinance that will hold public and private employers, as well as market landlords, accountable to make sure that they go through and do their due diligence when working with people with criminal arrest in their background.
Okay. What would be your next step?
Well, we made the presentation. We wanted to make sure that, you know, all of the city council individuals were on board with it.
Okay.
And we would be glad to answer other questions, you know, as they may arise. The good thing now, Mayor, is that 3 years ago, we may not have had all of the data that helped, you know, demonstrate the success that such a policy would have. But now, 3 years later, this has been implemented in some 18 states, several cities all across the nation, and we've got great testimony from key leadership in both public and private sector that are attesting to the value of giving and providing second chance opportunities. They're saying that it's impacted positively the economy, people in the community feel good about it, and it positions the city or the state as one in which people feel that they're going to get a fair chance at everything, possibly. So we think that now is a good time for the city of Waterloo to reevaluate such a policy. And even when it comes to knowing all of the ins and particulars of the city of Waterloo, that becomes mute now because we've seen the positive effect of what's happening in major metropolitan areas like New York, like Atlanta, like Baltimore. And so those things are going to work especially well here too then for a diversity like Waterloo.
Ms. Shears, do you know what would this action be? A resolution, an ordinance, a hearing? How would we approach this?
Well, without having talked to our legal counsel, if it is legal for the city council to pass a law, it would be an ordinance. Okay. So
We do want it to be municipal law so that we can have
so it would need to be an ordinance.
It, and then that would flow through our office, the Waterloo Commission on Human Rights.
Okay.
And so we're basically already doing that. It's just that, you know, if someone feels discriminated against in this particular area, then we would be able to help hold the employer, the landlord, accountable.
Okay, Mr. Schmidt.
Just had a couple quick questions. Abraham, what constitutes a felony? I mean, I'm not familiar enough with the law. What do you need to do to become charged with a felony?
Good question. I'm not.
Multiple things. I mean, everything from murder to
defined by state code.
Yeah. Give me the low level and work your way up if you could.
It's already defined.
It's defined by state code, yeah. Stephen. I mean, there's a plethora of activities that can classify as either a felony or a misdemeanor. A lot of it depends on how a person is charged.
Right.
You know, particularly in drug offenses, some might rise to the felony level, and others may not. So, boy, it would be a long list of things that a person could do to be a felony. And I'm not sure if they're actually listed individually. The definition of a felony is in the state code, and I can't recite that.
But it's precisely because of that difficulty, if you will, though, and how broad it is, that it's necessary, we believe, that employers, landlords are forced to do individualized assessments. Because when you check into someone's background, as opposed to dismissing them because they check felony, but then checking with them to see exactly why did you get this felony and how long ago it was and that kind of thing, you may find that actually giving this person a second chance has absolutely nothing to do with what's happening today in terms of your desire to put them in the employ or to perhaps give them space in a rental unit or something like that.
Well, I guess the reason I ask, it seems to me I've read or heard that, you know, a felon loses a variety of rights, a number of rights.
Well, that's true.
So I assume that a felony must be a reasonably serious crime. And so I was just curious what it was. I'm sure we'll find out about that as this conversation continues. Then the other question I had is, are you aware in Iowa what other cities have passed anything similar to this?
I'm not aware of any other city in Iowa that has even proposed this at this particular time in history. And so if Waterloo, in fact, does move ahead and pass a ban the box policy for the city, we will be, once again, a leader that others could follow and emulate.
That's all I got. Thank you.
Anybody else, Mr. Mayor?
Abraham. Yes, sir. Are we better off doing this statewide, going to the General Assembly and having them ban the box? Otherwise, we have a patchwork of regulations on the state. Well, I mean, is that, I know it's good that we may be a leader, but it may be also bad because, you know what I'm trying to say?
I do. Well, just to remind you, there's several cities already that have already passed the ban on the box, and the whole state has not. And so, depending on the diversity of the city, depending on the needs in the city, it may be necessary for the city to try to take the lead in passing something like this that will impact its constituents, you know. So I don't think that we will gain anything by waiting for the state, which may quite frankly react much more slowly to what we're proposing than the city just taking the lead and making this happen for the residents of Waterloo. We've got 70,000 people here. We're adjacent to another city that's 40,000 strong, and I think that by moving ahead, saying that we care about all of our citizens, sends a very powerful message, not only to the residents here in the Metroplex, but it also sends a very powerful message all over the state that as diversity capital, we believe that this is necessary at this time in history.
And Tom, if you will, because I did kind of in preparation, but if you just Google ban the box, there's a ton of information out there, and I was really quite amazed at the large number of cities, both large and small, right, across the country that have adopted this.
Milwaukee is one, and I put some information in the package, but yep. Milwaukee, right, just north of us, have also adopted it.
And this is just an idea, I'm just thinking out loud. Would we be better off by doing ordinance initially just for the city, taking baby steps before we make it for the whole city, private, public? And secondly, if we're going to proceed with this idea, I mean, it sounds like we are, we need to get the word out to the landlords and all the major employers so they're on board, so they have the information.
Sure.
So we don't just make a new ordinance and say, you guys right. have to follow this, and
right.
that's too bad.
You right, that's right. Say? No, I understand perfectly what you're saying. And the beauty of it, Councilman Lynn, is that we came to you 3 years ago. And at that particular time, you all said, let's postpone this indefinitely. But during that time, we didn't stop doing our work. We still had community conversations with employers, with residents, and that kind of thing. And, we just strengthened our resolve during that time that this is important. Meanwhile, while we were doing our thing in the city of Waterloo, cities all over the place were doing the same thing because of the need to make life a little more bearable for those who had criminal arrest in their background. So it's not going to be new. February 2014, this city council did pass a domestic violence ordinance. And so I think that we are already beginning to lay the groundwork for these kinds of policies that will continue to uplift everybody in community versus just a few.
Mr. Mayor?
Yes, ma'am.
Just to note for the record, the City of Waterloo does not ask about criminal conviction until we have selected candidates that are qualified based on their actual qualifications. So we technically don't have a box until you're actually being qualified for a position, and then we ask and do background checks when you're getting considered for the position. So we don't have a box.
We don't have a box that's required to be checked in the initial application.
Correct, because we don't ask for an application. We ask for a cover letter and resume, so we take what information the applicant wants to give us.
The other thing I just want to mention, too, is that Target, Walmart, Home Depot, these are three national companies that have already implemented Ban the Box, and they're in our community.
Mr. Morrissey, you have a question?
Yes, Director Funches, the box on the employer's applications that are within our municipality, when the employer uses those, if it is checked and they file 13, that is that against EEOC rules at the current time?
Absolutely, it's against EEOC rules presently.
Okay.
Presently. So there are already stipulations in the federal law as it is.
Oh, and there are, given the information that you presented and gave to us to review, it sounds like there's rules set in place that govern the employer's hiring practices to make hiring ex-felons something that is not discriminatory.
Right, indeed.
And so that is there, and simply put, what this ordinance is saying is that we would like the city of Waterloo and any employer within the municipality to remove that box so that that's not used in the initial part of the application for employment, so that that employer or human resource person looks at the qualifications first rather than file 13 in it, because it's got the check mark in a box that shouldn't be there anyway because it's not supposed to be practiced by law currently.
Correct, correct.
So this ordinance basically is just following through and cleaning up what the law requires employers to do now.
That's right. EEOC themselves have said they welcome the ban the box movement because it fleshes out a little bit better what they've already stipulated within the federal law as early as 2010 anyway.
Okay.
And so, yeah, so the idea is just to force employers, landlords even, to do a much better job of doing the individualized assessment, because we don't know what the background was, what the situations were at the time of the arrest and that kind of thing. And quite frankly, that raises another thing. There are some situations where, for instance, and this is in the packet as well, it's in the information, but a lot of times when you do these commercially backed background checks, they come up with faulty information. They say that you have an arrest, but there was never a conviction. And so what we end up doing, for instance, is we're penalizing people who may have had an arrest in the background, but it never led to a conviction. And those are the kinds of ways that people, well-qualified individuals, get shut out of the system. And we think that's patently unfair, particularly when it begins to affect a large group of individuals.
The other comment I'd like to make, and Tom, you'd address the thing about should go state or city. One of the things in reviewing this I noticed was that in at least a couple of states that I was reading about, the cities led the way and then the state followed suit and passed their law. I think California was one and Illinois was one that did that, with the cities leading the way with the ban the box before the state legislatures got on board.
Absolutely. And I think in our particular situation, in our particular situation with Waterloo being, as we affectionately refer to it, as the diversity capital of the state of Iowa, it would be a very proactive leadership move for us to pass ban the box and send a very important message to the rest of the state of Iowa.
Mr. Hart.
And then just real quickly, even if you take a look, I think there's 18 states currently that have some type of ban the box movement. And then our borders, Illinois, Minnesota, and Nebraska also have ban the box items as well for their statewide areas too. And there's hundreds of cities and hundreds and thousands of stories that you just alluded to with people wanting another opportunity that have made some mistakes in their lives. So,
absolutely. Yeah, this is not new at this time. We might have been a little ahead of our time 3 years ago, but now there's been so much more information, and we just believe that now is a good time.
All right. What, maybe, yes, sir. So I'm going to ask one more question. Would this in any way diminish the veterans' preference laws?
No, we don't think it has any connection at all to the veteran.
And secondly, Mr. Wood, you were an HR person. When you grade an applicant, your points on or on to an ABC, is a felony a lower grade?
Well, it depends on the felony. What we did, ours were any kind of violent crime that was a felony, was generally something that we didn't address. We did address. We did not hire on that. But I mean, there was, as Mayor said, there's hundreds of different things, and you'd be surprised how forthright people are coming forward and telling you their story. And there's so many people out there that deserve a second chance, and they've paid their debt to society, and yet they keep paying their debt and keep paying and keep paying, and pretty soon they say, why try anymore? So I'm not sure if I answered your question.
Well, some of them don't even make it to the that part of the process because they've already been taken out of that.
Absolutely. It's as an HR manager, my job was to take the people in and make sure that their qualifications met what the requirements of the job were. And, you know, if I'm, say I would have worked in a bank, would I hire somebody that mishandled funds? Probably not. But I worked at Tyson Foods. If somebody had, say, a felony for possession of marijuana with intent to deliver, something like that, and they're going to cut up meat, I mean, really, what bearing does that have on it? And a lot of it, you know, when you're interviewing somebody, how they enter the interview process, you know, if they sit up, you know, there's certain things you look at a person. I'm sure you all have talked to people, and you know, they sit, come up there, they sit, they answer your question, they don't slouch, talk on the phone, that type of stuff. I've had people like that. So it depends on the job, what they're being hired for. So, you know, the felony, as a general rule, no.
Let me just close with this. To be clear, we just want everybody to understand that we don't expect, and we're not asking this at all, for instance, for employers to put sex offenders in schools. We're not asking people with felonies, with theft, to work at a bank. I mean, these are things that, you know, just defy common sense. So we're not talking about that at all. We're talking about those more gray issues where a conversation can yield to some semblance of truth and give somebody a second chance opportunity, particularly if something has happened many, many years ago, it's past four, it's past seven, it's past 10 years old. It happened when they were young, and now they're much older. Since the time of the infraction, they probably received some education, or they received professional certifications. They have people in the community of repute who can write wonderful letters of recommendation for you, attesting to their character. We believe that those individuals should be given another opportunity.
Mr. Francis, maybe if I can try to simplify this as much as I can to understanding, and tell me if I'm right or wrong, it's called ban the box, because you're literally just asking employers to remove the box that says, have you been convicted of a felony?
Mm-hmm.
People either check it or they don't.
Right.
That's all you're asking to do. You're not asking employers to not do background checks. You're not forcing employers to hire people with felons. You're just saying, don't ask the question up front.
Right. We're asking them not to ask that up front, to make sure that they give everyone a real opportunity at the employment opportunity or the housing situation. And of course, we want the ordinance in place so that we can hold them accountable to make sure that they're not doing it.
All right. What I will do, counsel, from this standpoint is do some research to find out the authority that we have to pass such an ordinance.
And there's a model ordinance in the past.
Right. And I will work with Director Funches on a timeline. And, addressing Councilman Lynn's statement or question, which was a good one, is we do need to make sure that we have the opportunity for employers to be notified and to have a say in this process before we just pass an ordinance requiring us to do something.
That's fair.
Mr. Mayor,
and along those lines, so did I hear this is employers and landlords? Or just employers?
Yeah, we were talking about employers and landlords.
We want to have representatives from both groups. All right, I just want to clarify.
Mr. Mayor?
Yes, sir.
I would just ask that due diligence be used here, that if this was brought up in 2011, I think 4 years is too long, and I would hope that the ordinance is in place within at least 6 months, Mr. Mayor.
Are there further questions or comments? Thanks.
Thank you, Ron.
Thank you. Good presentation. Ladies and gentlemen, we have scheduled next a presentation by Main Street, or Street Smith Grout Museum. I'm confused with last one. I'm sorry. We can just roll right into that next one, even though we're early on that. If you guys are ready, just go ahead and please.
I'm just ready to tell you.
Okay. Just start by giving us your name, please.
Yes. I'm Judy Burfind. Do I have to do my address, too?
Yes.
2216 Highgate Lane, Cedar Falls, Iowa.
Okay.
I'm the chairman of the board at the Grant Museum District, and I'm representing several people who are here behind me. We had a committee, well, as you know, back in 2013, we had a vote on the cultural and science facilities levy. It did not pass, but one of the comments, we heard it frequently, was what kind of oversight would you have on those dollars? And so we've had a committee that have been meeting about this, and on the committee was Tim Ender from the city of Waterloo, Sharon Juwan, Billy Bailey, the director, and myself. So we have before you, I believe you have copies of this, is our attempt at looking at agreement. We are calling this a financial oversight resolution that would be established between the Grant Museum District and the city of Waterloo. And in complying with oversight requirements, we're saying there are certainly requirements by the state of Iowa. There are requirements by the Waterloo and Convention and Visitors Bureau because we do have some granting dollars from them. We have many other granting agencies and they have requirements too. That we will provide along with that, that we will continue to designate two seats on our city council for city council members. And right now, those seats are occupied by Pat Morrissey and Ron Welber. And I have to say that they are very faithful in coming and participating. And we appreciate that very much. Secondly, we continue with the recently expanded Budget Financial Oversight Committee that was created this last year, and it develops and monitors our operating budget. And this includes, at this point, one city council person, and that is Pat. And then we have Grant Museum District Board members, and some of those are residents of Waterloo. I am not, but I grew up in Waterloo, so that counts for something, I think. And then also appropriate staff. Thirdly, we would intend to provide semi-annual reports to the City Council, providing the opportunity for public comment and input so that when that information is presented, the public can come forward and ask questions about those dollars and how they're being used. We also currently and would continue to submit an annual operating budget and a financial audit to reporting to the city. Our fiscal year is July 1st through June 30th, and you receive, as I say, those reports already. This is kind of not a long, detailed resolution, but we feel that we've covered the bases. We spent quite a bit of time. We had the city attorney come and visit with us, and we also had Noel come and talk to us, too. So this is what we present before you for your consideration.
Okay, and that is on the agenda tonight for a vote, if I'm
yes.
correct. Okay.
Yes.
You have questions? Council, do you have questions of Ms. Burfine? Well, you did it. Yes, sir, Mr. Lynn.
Yes.
And I don't know if this is about this or the whole vote. You have two council members and a council member that's for the oversight. Are those three separate people, or two, and then one of them does two things?
Two, and one of them does two things.
Would you entertain having three?
Certainly.
And then and the other thing I think you should entertain is probably specifying that one of the oversight people is the at-large, one of the at-large seats. I mean, not for me, but only because, as you know, the at-large seats represent the entire community.
Okay.
And that may give the appearance, at least, of a little more oversight, or at least responsiveness to the whole city.
I think part of the, in reacting to that, I don't have any problem with that at all, is you are very busy people, and it's one more set of meetings. So,
how often does the oversight board meet?
It meets quite frequently when it's budget time.
Okay.
And then throughout the year, it doesn't meet as often.
Okay.
Just kind of tweaking it. It has to, any changes on the budget have to go before the board.
Okay.
Are you subject to the open meetings law?
We are not.
Will you be?
No.
You won't?
No. We talked a lot about that, and we thought that perhaps the city council would provide that public input when we came semi-annually and reported.
Would you entertain entertain putting that in your agreement, and even though you don't have to comply, you would voluntarily comply.
I think anybody could come in and request to speak to the board, but as far as coming and sitting through the meeting, I'm not quite sure.
And this is a question, I think, for Michelle. I want to make sure I'm clear on this money. $600,000, are we talking about maybe generating?
So in your CFO, I don't think I've seen the language they're asking for. 27 cents, if that's the levy amount they're asking for, is approximately $600,000 a year.
And a residential property owner will pay 100% of his levy into the grout.
The way it's going to work, that 27 cents levy will go on every property tax bill for every property. So a residential home, let's say it's assessed at $100,000, it's going to be subject to a rollback to maybe 55%, and then they're going to pay 27 cents on the $55,000. A commercial or industrial property will operate the same way.
Except, as I understand it, if you're in a TIF, like the tax works, and say there's $50 million valuation, they'll be taxed, but that tax won't go to them, it'll go to the TIF.
That is the way TIF law works. All levies are collected from all properties if they are in a TIF and it's in the increment and the city elects to use to receive the increment, it will go to the TIF.
So the residential property owner will pay for the grout.
Generally. I think there's a misunderstanding maybe about TIF. The base in a TIF always goes. So, you know, the tech works today, I don't know what the value is there today, but let's say it was $1 million today. The 27 cents on that million would go.
Sure, I understand.
And
but the $50 million.
But the increment right. That doesn't exist yet would not. Yeah. That's true.
Can I ask you a question about the need for $600,000? You're losing about $260,000 a year, not losing, but expenses no. Exceed revenues.
Exactly.
Why are you asking for $600,000 if you only need $260,000?
Well, we haven't given salaries raises for 2 years. We live hand to mouth. Believe it or not, we do have, I know everybody says, oh wow, you've got an endowment, but the endowment is just being nicked away. There's not much of that. We're also planning to the future. We raise privately from donors about $500,000 a year. That is a lot of work, a lot of staff time. And I have to tell you that the environment for how this museum was created and over the years, how it had been funded has changed dramatically. We just lost three fantastic board members in this past year that passed away. They were all very, very generous people, very generous. We don't have those gifts anymore. There aren't those kind of donors who step up to the table.
You pick that for property taxes?
I can't answer that.
Do we pay property taxes?
We do not.
Did you get Vision Iowa funds when we did the Vision Iowa?
We did, for the Sullivan Museum.
How much did you get?
At Destilly. $1.5 million. Wow. That was an $11 million project.
Thanks.
Mr. Schmidt?
A couple questions I've heard in the community. Is there a possibility of this being a countywide tax rather than just Waterloo only?
Unfortunately, the way the Code of Iowa is written, it says in the municipality, and so that means just restricted to Waterloo.
Okay. And then do you know or can you tell me how similar museums in Dubuque, Cedar Rapids, Des Moines, how are they funded? Do you know?
Much the same way we are, but let me ask the expert.
Billy, why don't you come on, please?
She has the nuts and bolts.
Yeah. How are other museums in other communities funded, was the question.
Well, it depends on the museum. There are museums that are supported by municipal or county funds or state funds. It's State Historical Society comes to mind in Des Moines. Many of the history and science museums, like the Grout, were the Putnam comes to mind here in Davenport. It was founded by a philanthropic individual who left money in an endowment, which at the time was adequate. Then the needs of the community changed, and the endowment went up and down and up and down. And most of those institutions are funded very similar to the way the Grout is currently funded, a combination of earned revenue, which is admissions and workshops and classes, grants, private donations, memberships, those kinds of things. So the average museum in the United States receives about 24% of their operating support from governmental entities, and that's all levels. Everything from municipal to county to state to federal. So we're trying to fill that gap for the Grout Museum District, and as Judy said, plan for the future and allow us to have a secure funding level to take care of times when the roof leaks or we have other issues on the campus.
Thank you.
So,
Mr. Schmidt.
So to approve this, would that be, are you saying that would be kind of unique in Iowa as far as museums go, that other museums or no other museums?
There, I think there are three in Iowa. Okay. In 2013, when we had our first election, I believe it's Manning passed one. And there are two other communities that, and I can't call them to name right off the top of my head, but I can get that to you, that currently have had it longer than that.
Okay. And then the one other question I was given is, has there been any consideration to if we can't include the rest of the Greater Cedar Valley on the support, then is there a way of giving the Waterloo residents a discount, whether it's, you know, a buck 50% if it's just for the students? I mean, sure. Has some consideration been given to that?
Sure. We certainly have talked long and hard about that. I would not like to see that written into something like this because I think that's very fluid. But I would think that there would be something that could be done, say, there could be a free day once a week, there could be a 15% discount. If you show your Waterloo driver's license, that there would be something. Yes.
All right, thank you.
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Wolf.
I just want to make a comment on what Mr. Lynn said there. All seven of us represent all the citizens of Waterloo. Five of us are elected by our ward, but we still represent all the citizens. I answer many calls outside Ward 5.
Thank you.
Just so, follow up on that.
Mrs. Morrison?
Yeah, Judy, how much of the endowment has been used that has to be repaid?
Right now, we're probably about $400,000 below what's called a restricted level. Now, in the last couple of years, we've had some gifts that have been given that we've been able to pay back towards that, but that's where we are right now.
Do you believe that the people of Waterloo understand the endowment as they're set up, and that even though you may have a couple million dollars in endowments, they're not to be touched? Do you think the main citizenry understand that?
No, I don't.
Is there a way to get that across to people so that what you're asking for is completely understood in reference to what the endowments are there for and how they cannot be used and should not be used and need to be replenished, repaid?
I am open to suggestions. We all are. You know, we've tried very hard. It's a complicated issue. Just because you have money sitting in the bank doesn't mean you can always touch it and use it. And I think we've all known churches that have been endowment rich and they are poor in their daily paying of their bills, and that's kind of a little bit of where we are. We have some endowment, but it is restricted, and it's restricted by the donor. The donor says, I'm giving you $100,000, but you are to use it only for this specific item. Or we had endowment given to the Rensselaer Russell House, so there's a very restricted endowment. And one of the things that happened after 2013 is that the Russell House essentially closed. So it is only open by appointment. It has been open in the summer and in the afternoon with volunteers.
Judy, what the levy is asking for and what it would be doing, if hopefully it will pass, is create a public-private partnership with the Grout Museum and the City of Waterloo.
That's correct, and that's what this is reflecting, that public-private partnership, much as you have with Main Street and the Alliance.
And I think, Pat, that's a good point that you just made, Judy, is that last Monday, Council voted on agreeing to put the measure on the ballot, which we were obligated to do anyway. This item tonight that's on the agenda is very narrowly defined as just the oversight committee that will oversee the funding should that pass. So you know that's the item that's on the agenda tonight. It's just the creation of the oversight board from the city.
That's right. It has no bearing on the levy passing or not passing.
That's correct.
It only goes into force if the levy passes.
That's correct. Mr. Schmidt?
Just one point of clarification, I guess. The mention about Main Street, I think this would be very different than how we're set up with Main Street, because with Main Street, as I understand it, and I'm certainly open to clarification, but with Main Street, the council every year votes to give them X number of dollars.
Right.
I think we do that with the Grout also.
Not on a regular basis. We have come to you asking, and we have been given some of the mayor's discretionary fund.
Yeah, that's an application.
And hotel motel.
Right.
And hotel motel. I mean,
that goes to hotel motel. We apply for that.
But my point is, Main Street, there's no money locked in for Main Street.
It's not a tax levy. Is that correct?
That's my point. It's not a tax levy.
It's not a tax levy.
Right.
No, but we annually give Main Street whatever the amount is, I can't remember.
But we're not locking the taxpayer. I don't want this to sound like I'm not supportive of the Grout. I just want to make sure we're clear that this and the relationship we've got in the Main Street is not the same thing.
They're totally different.
Okay.
But
all
it's
right,
public
that's
private.
Right.
Yes.
All right. Yep. All right. Thank you.
Okay. Further? Anybody? Our conversation has kind of drifted a little bit off of what I believe that the Grout Board is asking us to do today is on the ordinance or on the agenda tonight is to approve the ordinance that would create an oversight board should the measure pass on the ballot, which is in response to many of the comments from the last measure that failed was who's going to oversee the spending of this money. What you're doing now is answering those critics, if you will, that didn't think that there was proper oversight, and what they are doing is creating that oversight board. That's what you're asking us to do tonight.
Mayor, I will just note that it's not an ordinance creating an oversight board. It is just an agreement with the city, basically them agreeing to how they're going to allow the oversight from the city. So,
but it
the
is an
city,
ordinance.
No.
Oh, I thought it was.
No, it's
sorry.
A resolution.
Okay.
It's
my mistake. My mistake.
There's no board.
Mayor, there is an issue that this council needs to consider. I don't know how many board members there are on the Grout, but if the city council's appointing a majority of their board members, that creates an issue.
No. We have 16 currently serving, and there are two city council people.
Yeah. Okay, very good. Thank you, everybody. Thanks, Judy. Thanks, Bill.
Thank you.
Very much.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? We're adjourned. Thank you.
boards and commission meeting together. Madam Secretary, if you'd read the roll, please.
Yes, Mr. Schmidt?
Here.
Mr. Hart? Mr. Jones?
Here.
Here.
Mr. Mayor, have you got a gavel?
Gavel.
Could you help us out?
Please, we have a meeting going on.
Motion to approve the agenda.
Second.
We have a motion and a proper second on the agenda. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, same sign. Would one of you gentlemen like to take those items?
Mr. Chair, I move that Bruce Kaiser be approved for the ADA Compliance Commission with the expiration date of 8/24/2018, and Jay Connor be appointed to the Plumbing Board of Licensing Examiners and Appeals with the same expiration date.
Second.
We have a motion and a second on those two appointments. Any questions, comments, concerns?
No.
Seeing none, all in favor signify by vote of aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Those two gentlemen are approved.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
Motion and second to adjourn. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
We are adjourned. Thank you.
Steve, no.
Let's call the Finance Committee meeting to order. Madam Clerk, would you please read the roll?
Yes, Ms. Cole?
Here.
Mr. Schmidt? Mr. Jones?
Here.
Motion for the agenda and approval of the minutes of August 17th.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? Seeing none, all in favor, vote by the sign of aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, same sign. We have an agenda.
Madam Chairperson, I can go ahead and take those first few items.
Thank you.
First, we have Abraham Funches, Executive Director, Ryan Wood, Commission Chair, Cheryl Ferries, Vice Chair, Benny Spain, Commissioner, to go to the IAOHRA conference in Birmingham, Alabama, at an amount not to exceed $10,572.40. Next, we have Cheryl Huddleston, Human Resources Manager for the Iowa Employment Conference, Fit for Duty in Altoona, Iowa, October 27th, at an amount not to exceed $230. And then finally, we have Keith Kasperi, Airport Director and Maintenance Employees, Rusty Zay, Randy Shepard, Troy Deeds, and Chris Preston, to go to the Live Aircraft Fire Hot Burning Training at the Dubuque Regional Airport, September 23rd, 24th, at an amount not to exceed $1,600. I move we approve those three items.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. I have a question to start with. Item number one, $10,572.40 for the Human Rights Commission. Is that, I couldn't find in the documentation if that was grant funded. And here comes Abraham, who can tell us.
Yes, yes. As a matter of fact, yes, we've got partnership funding that we can use from the Department of HUD for that trip.
Okay.
I have
Thank
a question,
you.
Abraham, if you want to step there. So is that money that could be used for other things here locally within the community, or can that only be used for this purpose?
No. The money, we wrote for this grant, mm-hmm. and we got $120,000 in partnership funding in addition to some other monies that we got previous years. And that money can be used for education and outreach here locally, which we have done. And it's also designed to be used for staff and commissioners for additional training, like this trip that's coming up in Birmingham. It's a once in a lifetime opportunity. It's a 50-year celebration of major civil rights pieces, and there's going to be training with employment, training with housing, fair housing, affirmatively furthering fair housing, et cetera.
Okay. Anything else, gentlemen? Mm-hmm. All in favor, vote by the sign of aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, same sign.
I would vote no on one, yes on two and three.
Okay, and now we have the pre-authorizations.
Pre-authorizations, we have airport, the amount of $2,000. Staff is requesting not to exceed $2,000 to perform general repairs on the airport sedan that is driven by the airport director for day-to-day use. Airport, $3,850. Staff is requesting approval to purchase an additional two pallets or 3,000 pounds of Craft Co. joint pavement sealant. Request includes two-day rental of tar kettle. Building maintenance, $3,942. Pay station for parking ramp at West 5th and Commercial. Central garage, $2,750. Annual fire pump test on 10 apparatus. Central garage, $8,375 for transmission for dump truck B09. Central garage, $4,659.61 for turbocharger for ambulance 338. Engineering, $1,524 for mobile connect and mobile license maintenance renewal for the Pave Plus View and Map Director ARC GIS software. Engineering, $1,100 for one pallet of Pine Hall brick, English Edge Autumn, plus pallet rental. Finance, $15,552 for advance payment of 50% of Hotel Motel Partnership grant funds awarded to Grout Museum by the CVB. Human Resources, not to exceed $20,000 for biometric wellness screening. Leisure Services, $1,303.14 for membership cards for the Cedar Valley Sportsplex. Leisure Services, $11,500. Engineering and Design Services for fiscal year 2016. Leisure Services roof replacement. Leisure Services, $2,000 for scorecards for the golf course. Planning, $2,325 for demo of foundations. Police, $3,800 for 2B3 dual antenna radar units for squad cars. Police, $22,000 for 24 Dell desktop computers, monitors, sound bars. Police, $90,000 for upgrade the video server and purchase of up to 150 body cameras for L3 communications. Police, $5,600, partnering with Hawkeye Community College to hold 2 one-day classes on arresting communication for Waterloo Police Department.
Second.
Hold on.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Almost. Sanitation, $1,200 for removal of hazardous trees per court order.
Second.
We have a motion and a second, and I assume we'll have some discussion.
I got a couple questions.
Yes, sir.
Building maintenance, $3,942 for the pay station parking ramp. That's all part of our ongoing agreement and factored in with Republic.
Yep, Craig Clark, building official. Yes, what this actually does is give us the capability to take credit cards at the parking ramp, so that'll be a very nice upgrade for people visiting.
Good, thank you. And then also, human resources, I think it is. If I could just have a little overview on the $20,000 for the biometric wellness screening.
Yes, what that is going to be is in partnership with Allen Occupational Health, we will be at our safety wellness fair and at the police and fire training. We are asking to bring in Allen Occupational Health to do a basic biometric screening, which I don't want to say is in place of one's physical, but it is a component we have found through the years trying to reduce our healthcare claims that we have a lower than average utilization of wellness preventative checkups, and we have a higher than normal disease rate. And so lots of studies have shown that by getting this and bringing it to your employees, you can help catch, early detect some of these things. It's cheaper than if they went to their own doctor to do it. Not that we're telling them not to go to their doctor, but we're hoping that by getting those test results, they will go to their doctor if there's something necessary. So it will come out of our regular health insurance budget. So we're not asking to have it come from anywhere different. It would be the same as if they went to their doctor to get that blood screening, but we're bringing the nurses to them. So it will be optional for the employee, but we're hoping to strongly encourage it as we go forward, because we need to identify what the city will get out of that. The employees will get their actual results sent to their home, but what the city will get is a comprehensive report of where our risk factors are and where we need to be focusing our education in the future, so that we can help lower some of those risk factors and continue to decrease our insurance rates. And they will be able to take these results to their doctor, which should mean they won't need to get these blood results at their checkup. They'll just do their regular checkup instead of having, and then not need a blood draw, because it's every, it checks everything that you would get at a regular checkup and then a few other factors.
So I am probably one of the least medical people in the world. So are these similar to those Lifeline or Life Screen or whatever it is I get about every 6 months in the mail, where they check your bone density and they check about four different things for you?
No, this will check your blood sugar, your cholesterol, your thyroid. There's 23 things that the blood draw test. It's literally like when I go to the doctor and they do a blood draw, I think they check for 12 or 13 things. This checks for 23, but it will give the employee a comprehensive look at their health. And they'll also be doing their height, their weight, their blood pressure, all of the things that you would do at a checkup.
Gotcha. So. Okay, thank you.
Yep.
Okay. All in favor, vote by the sign of aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, same sign. Those items pass. I move that we approve the four budget line item amendments. Copies are on file in the city clerk's office. And also that we pay the bills this week, which are $4,893,039.07, 4,893,039.07.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. All in favor, vote by the sign of aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, same sign. Those items pass. I move that we adjourn.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Thank you for your time.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. If I could please call this this meeting to order, please. We have a large crowd in session tonight in the council chambers. Welcome to all of you.
This is the regularly scheduled meeting of the Waterloo City Council this Monday, August 24th. Madam Clerk, would you read the roll, please?
Certainly. Ms. Cole?
Here.
Mr. Jones?
Here.
Mr. Schmidt?
Here.
Mr. Lynn?
Here.
Mr. Morrissey?
Here.
Mr. Welper?
Here.
Mr. Hart?
Here.
Very good. Thank you. If all of you would join me, please, in standing, and those of you that can, for a moment of silent reflection or prayer, please. Thank you very much. Our Pledge of Allegiance tonight is going to be led by Mr. Kent Schenkel, our Director of Cultural and Arts. Kent, please.
Please join me in reciting our pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you very much. Let me see. Mr. Hart, please.
I'd like to make a motion to approve an amended agenda, and that amendment is to add three travel requests, which were on the Finance Committee agenda, but inadvertently admitted from the Council agenda. Also, with the amended agenda, I move that we approve the minutes of August 17th regular session.
Second.
Council, do you have any questions or comments regarding either tonight's agenda or the minutes?
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Lamb.
Can we consider 1B, whatever it is, A, separately?
What is it? Which one is it?
First travel request.
It's on the amendment. It's an amendment.
Well, we can, Mr. Lamb. Can we just, I mean, you can discuss it now if you'd like. We can certainly take it off if that's your request. But, and since you made the request, I would.
Well, we can talk about it.
Yeah. There has been a motion. I'm sorry, there hasn't been a motion. When we make the motion for the consent agenda, if you would like to discuss that particular one, we certainly can do so.
Okay.
And then we won't have to take it off.
Thank you.
If that would work for you.
That's fine.
Okay. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, same sign. That motion carries.
Mr. Mayor, I make a motion that we receive, place on file, and approve the consent agenda items 1A through B10. Also, with the approval of the consent agenda, I move that we make our bills payment, which will be read by our finance chair.
The bills this week are $4,893,039.07. 4,893,039.07.
Second.
Very good. Now, Council, do you have any questions or comments regarding consent agenda? Mr. Lynn.
The question I have on the travel, the $10,000 amount, do we really need to send four people? Do we send two, save half the money? It just seems like it's a fair housing funds, but it's for a Voting Rights Act deal. They don't seem to be the same thing to me.
You're not used to that microphone. Those that use it regularly know it falls off.
They don't touch it.
Okay.
Abraham Funches, Director of World Commission on Human Rights. No, we actually have, the money is designed to take care of investigative work here locally, education and outreach, and of course planning and training. So we haven't really tapped into using the monies to actually engage in much training for trips like this, which is designed, quite frankly, with emphasis on employment as well as fair housing. It's a combination because this is the human rights, this is the International Association of Human Rights Organizations that is meeting in Birmingham. And it's coinciding with major civil rights successes over the last 50 years. This is the 50 year anniversary. And quite frankly, the intention initially was to take staff and commissioners. And we fully vetted the commission and we were able to take it down to about four. So we feel that we've done due diligence to try to minimize cost as it is. Initially, we wanted to travel by van, but when we got down to so low, we could change our motor transportation.
Are these federal funds?
Yes, these are the monies that we wrote for. We applied, wrote for, and got partnership funding through the Department of HUD. And we got $120,000 this year. This is on top of $66,000 we were able to get in a previous year during my administration. So we've been using these monies and in compliance with the way they're supposed to be used.
It seems to me, though, that that's just an eye-popping number for a trip. And I guess you're the expert. If you truly believe we need to do this, the only thing I see is, and when I look at your budget, you've blown through the whole budget for the year. For the fiscal year, you only have $912 left.
Yeah, no, actually, we actually have more money than what you have reflected on your paperwork, apparently, because we do have some additional dollars to work with. But we're using the monies the way they're designed to be used for, again, investigative pieces here locally, education and outreach, as well as training.
Well, I hope you appreciate that I have to ask the question because I represent constituents.
I respect your word.
If you're the expert and you're telling me that we need to do this.
We need to do this.
Go have a good time.
Thank you.
You can't put a price on the type of work that the commissioners do for the Human Rights Department. So $10,000 to help with all the challenges and problems that we have within the local community. It's a small price to pay for human rights.
Okay, are there further questions, Mr. Schmidt?
Mr. Mayor, I had questions on item 1B2A, Alley's Liquor, and 1B2E, Westside Liquor, 919 West 5th. Haven't we had issues at both of those establishments in the past 6 months, or am I mixing those up with some other locations?
I don't know. Dan, I'm assuming, Mr. Schmidt, that since they're on there, they have been vetted by the police department and the fire department. But as far as the number of calls there or what kind of issues we've had, that I don't know. Dan, can you, without research, tell? He's shaking his head no, so I'm assuming you're in the same boat I am. I don't know.
All right.
Mr. Schmidt, I'm sorry.
Thank you.
Are there further questions? Very good. Madam Clerk, it's a roll call vote, please, for the consent agenda.
Okay. Ms. Cole?
Yes.
Mr. Jones?
Yes.
Mr. Schmidt?
I would vote yes on everything except 1B1A, the travel request. I'd vote no on those. I think that type of travel, that kind of money, sets a real bad precedent, and I also think that money should be spent here locally.
Mr. Lind?
Yes, except 1B1A.
Mr. Morrissey?
Yes.
Mr. Welper?
Yes.
Mr. Hart?
Yes.
Thank you.
Very good. The motions carry, and I do want to recognize a couple of people. Jake Connor, and I don't know Jake. Jake, are you here? Jake is not here, but he has been appointed to our Plumbing Board of Licensing Examiners and Appeals, and his term will run through August 24th of 2018. So, Jake, if you're watching, congratulations and welcome to the city and boards and commissions, and a special thank you and appreciation to Bruce Kaser. Bruce is here tonight. Bruce is a regular visitor. Bruce, wave your hand at us if you would, please. Okay. Thank you, Bruce, for stepping up. Bruce asked if he could serve on our ADA Compliance Commission, and we had a spot, fortunately. So, Bruce, thank you for volunteering your time and your talents to that very important board, and I'm sure you're going to bring a lot to that board. So welcome to you, and Bruce's appointment also goes through August 24th of 2018. So congratulations to both of those fine gentlemen for stepping up and volunteering on our boards and commissions. Thank you. All right, public hearings, item number two.
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Schmidt.
Item number two is a motion to receive and file proof of publication of notice of public hearing, and that's for the sale and conveyance of city-owned property at 1027 Lafayette Street to Jose Vanilla Gutierrez and Simona del Carmen Zavala with a purchase price of $92,000 through the Neighborhood Stabilization Program.
Second.
All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, same sign. Motion carries, and the hearing is now open. Madam Clerk, did we have any written objections on file to item number two?
There were none.
Is there anyone in our audience that would like to speak either for or against our item number two, the sale of some city-owned property to Jose Gutierrez and Simona Zavala? A second time.
Mr. Mayor, I make a motion and close the hearing.
Second.
Council, do you have any questions or concerns regarding item number two? All in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed, same sign. That motion carries.
Mr. Mayor, I'd like to adopt a resolution and authorizing said sale and conveyance and authorize city attorney to prepare and deliver deed accordingly.
Second.
Madam Clerk, that's a roll call vote, please.
Mr. Jones?
Yes.
Mr. Schmidt?
Yes.
Mr. Lynn?
Yes.
Mr. Morrison?
Yes.
Mr. Welper?
Yes.
Mr. Hart?
Yes.
Ms. Cole?
Yes.
Very good. Item two passes. Item number three, please.
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Hart?
I move to receive and file proof of publication of notice of public hearing for a resolution approving the request by Bertha Johnson to purchase a home at 528 Fowler Street in the amount of $5,000 with the development agreement.
Second. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, same sign. That motion carries. Madam Clerk, and the hearing is now open. Madam Clerk, did we have any written objections on item number three?
There were none.
Is there anyone in the audience that would like to speak either for or against the request of Bertha Johnson to purchase a home at 528 Fowler Street? Second time.
Mr. Mayor, I move to close the hearing.
Second.
Council, do you have any questions or comments?
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Schmidt.
I just ask, how did we arrive at that price? Is that $5,000 kind of our minimum net?
We set a purchase policy some time ago. Council did a minimum bid on the, I believe it's a 657A house, mm-hmm. and a minimum bid of $5,000.
And I assume that was the only one we got. And
I'm assuming that also. Yes, that was the only bid we got.
Thank you.
Very good. Further questions or comments? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion carries.
Mr. Mayor, I move to adopt a resolution authorizing sale and conveyance and authorize city attorney to prepare and deliver deed accordingly.
Second.
Madam Clerk, please.
Mr. Schmidt?
Yes.
Mr. Lynn?
Yes.
Mr. Morrissey?
Yes.
Mr. Welper?
Yes.
Mr. Hart?
Yes.
Ms. Cole?
Yes.
Mr. Jones?
Yes.
Very good. The motion carries.
Mr. Mayor, I move to adopt a resolution approving development agreement and authorize mayor and city clerk to execute the agreement.
Second.
Madam Clerk, please.
Mr. Lind?
Yes.
Mr. Morrissey?
Yes.
Mr. Welper?
Yes.
Mr. Hart?
Yes.
Ms. Cole?
Yes.
Mr. Jones?
Yes.
Mr. Schmidt?
Yes.
Very good. That motion carries. That's all of our hearings tonight, ladies and gentlemen. Let's do resolutions, and if we could take them three at a time, please.
Mr. Mayor.
Ms. Cole.
Item four is a resolution declaring an obsolete bomb trailer and two damaged speed trailers surplus items and authorizing the disposal of said items.
Second.
Five is a resolution approving creative services agreement with Hellman Associates, Inc. for $60,000 to produce and air primetime local TV commercials for traffic safety and authorize the mayor to sign and execute said agreement. Six is a resolution approving a tolling agreement extending date to April 1st, 2016 and authorizing mayor to execute said document.
Second.
Very good. Council, any questions or comments on either of those three?
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Lynn.
Can you have the attorney, our attorney, explain exactly what a tolling agreement, the primary purpose of the tolling agreement?
The tolling agreement, Mr. Lynn, is our agreement that we will eventually have on council for the consent decree for EPA. EPA has requested, at their request, to extend that another 6 months. I think it's the one that we have in effect right now expires the end of September. And we are still negotiating with them, as everyone knows. So at EPA's request, we are asking to extend that agreement for until April 1st, 2016. Did I say that correctly, Mr. Zalford?
So the September 30th deadline is no longer?
Well, it doesn't mean that it's no longer, but we are still negotiating. And while we are shooting for a September 30th, if we don't make that deadline, we would like to have the opportunity, both EPA and us would like to have the opportunity to continue to negotiate on that. Without an extension, we're handcuffed at September 30th.
Are we better off going to federal court?
Well, I would certainly hope not. I don't think we want a judge to determine our fate. I think we would like to be able to work that out, and we still are. We are still negotiating with that. So.
I'm sorry. Go ahead.
I was done.
So this is at their request rather than ours? I thought the whole, this is what, the fifth extension, I believe?
Is that right? I don't know. It could be, Steve. It's Four, at least. Yeah.
Okay.
I'm sorry?
I think it is the fifth.
Fifth, okay.
I mean, do we have any idea why they're being delayed? And I guess the question is, while this continues to click on, are the costs going up? Are the legal fees continuing? I mean, what's the benefit in doing this? Because to defer to Mr. Lynn's comment, I believe I've read that several communities around the country are in lawsuits with the EPA for an overreach and overextension on their part. And I mean, it kind of seems to me if that's where we're going to end up, the sooner the better. But I don't know that, so that's why I'm asking. You know, what happens for the next 6 months?
Everything stays status quo. Well, I'll ask. Maybe Mr. Zellifer can further clarify that.
Well, I'm not a part of the EPA litigation team. That's others. But I do know that an extension is in the city's best interest. We can work this out. I think we can, but we don't want to do it hastily. And the September 30th deadline might not give us enough time to work it all out. And if everybody agrees to a six-month extension to allow us to avoid going to federal court and spending a heck of a lot more money, then I think it's in our best interest to do it.
So are you assuming if we went to federal court, we lose? Is that what
I'm not assuming anything. Okay. I'm assuming that we're going to be spending a lot of money. And I think we can negotiate this thing to its conclusion.
Okay. Do you know how much money we've spent so far?
No, I don't.
Does anybody? Okay. Well, I'm ballpark. $50,000, $200,000?
At least 100.
Yeah, I don't. I think it's maybe improper to guess. Mr. Schmidt, if you'd like to know how much we've spent in attorney fees, I'm sure we can get that to you and get an accurate number.
Okay.
And if you'd like that, I'm sure Ms. Wiener can get that.
Okay. If I could, that'd be great. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Mayor and City Council, Dave Dreyer, 3145 West 4th Street. I believe that the question was asked is, what is a tolling agreement? And I haven't heard the answer.
A tolling agreement it tolls the end of the process. It extends the end of the process. A tolling agreement. Tolling is just a legal term that it suspends the date that has been set, which is September 30th, for this city and the EPA DOJ to come to an agreement. The tolling agreement tolls that agreement. It extends that agreement for 6 months. Mr. Zellifer, he wants to know what we're tolling,
what is the agreement?
The agreement is there will eventually be a consent decree that will be entered into between the state, or excuse me, between the city and the federal government, the EPA, DOJ. That is an inevitability, Mr. Dreyer. We are still working out the details on that, hopefully to our advantage. As long as we can extend this and as long as we can have dialogue and negotiate on all of the bazillion different things that are going to be agreed upon, that's to our advantage. So we're tolling that, we're extending that agreement to give us more time to negotiate. Thanks, Dave. Is that sufficient, Mr. Dreyer? Okay, thank you.
Mr. Mayor?
Yes, sir?
Number five?
Yes, sir.
I'm wondering if we could hear a little bit about what that includes. Is it just for vehicles, or does it include pedestrians, bicyclists? Is it kind of
Sandy, please.
Road safety across the board?
Sandy Creek, Superintendent of Traffic. All of the above. It's a traffic safety commercials that are being produced through Hillman. And it'll have to do with bicycle safety, pedestrian crossing, children, also vehicle safety.
Great, thank you.
Thanks, Sandy. Further questions on 4, 5, or 6? Madam Clerk, please.
Mr. Morrissey?
Yes.
Mr. Wolper?
Yes.
Mr. Hart?
Yes.
Ms. Cole?
Yes.
Mr. Jones?
Yes.
Mr. Schmidt?
Yes on 4, 5, no on 6.
Mr. Lind.
Yes, 4 and 5, no on 6.
Items 7, 8, and 9, please.
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Hart.
Move to adopt a resolution recommending final acceptance of a John Deere utility vehicle with snowblower and boom from P&K Midwest of Waverly, Iowa, and approve the release of pay estimate number 2, final in the amount of $4,441 for the snow removal equipment for the airport. via Federal Aviation Administration's Airport Improvement Program grant. In 8, I move to adopt a resolution approving acceptance of Department of Transportation's Office of Aviation grant number 9-I-160-ALO-200 via the Commercial Service Vertical Infrastructure Program in the amount of $101,196 for the completion of projects in the FY 2016 IDOT application for improvements associated with the phase two of two improvements for aircraft storage hangar number 4 and the replacement and installation of doors in the baggage makeup and baggage claim areas in the airline passenger terminal building at the Waterloo Regional Airport, and authorize Mayor and City Clerk to sign the documents where indicated. And then number 9, I move to adopt a resolution approving memorandum of agreement with Waterloo Community School District to provide network services and supplemental technology support on an as-needed basis at a rate of $60 per hour for non-emergency issues and $90 per hour for emergency and after-hour issues.
Second.
Thank you. Madam Clerk, please. I'm sorry. Council, do you have any questions or comments on 7, 8, or 9? Mr. Schmidt.
Mr. Mayor, I was wondering on item number 9, Mr. Youngblood, do you have a kind of a guesstimate on how much time or how much money you're going to be requiring from the schools based on last year?
Chris Youngblood, Director of IT. Based on last year and the number of tickets that they performed for us last year, I estimated the yearly spend to be about $30,000 if we were unable to kind of take some of that load off of them, which I think we will. So that's kind of just based on last year's figures.
So roughly 500 hours?
I don't have a number of hours.
Okay, that's close.
But just the dollar
amount. All right, thanks.
Yep. Further questions on 7, 8, or 9?
Mr. Mayor.
Yes, sir, Mr. Lynn.
And question of why we're using them rather than...
Tom, would you... Talking
we're using them rather than set up for bid because they're familiar with our system.
They're familiar with our system, and it kind of gives us more time to kind of see what we want to do long term.
Sure. Thanks.
Thank you. Further questions? Madam Clerk, please.
Mr. Welper?
Yes.
Mr. Hart?
Yes.
Ms. Cole?
Yes.
Mr. Jones?
Yes.
Mr. Schmidt?
Yes.
Mr. Lind?
Yes.
Mr. Morrissey?
Yes.
The motion carries. 10, 11, and 12, please.
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Morrison.
I'd like to make a motion to adopt a resolution approving award of contract to Carpenter Uniform of Des Moines, Iowa at a cost of $54,964 for the purchase of Level 3 tactical body armor. Number 11, a resolution approving construction plans for sanitary sewer serving the Fisher Drive Sanitary Sewer Extension as submitted by the City of Waterloo Engineering Department and Sewage Treatment Agreement DNR Form 28A, September 2010. With the Department of Natural Resources and the final acceptance of construction plans subject to the review and acceptance by the DNR and authorized mayor to execute said document. Number 12, a resolution approving an amendment to the real estate purchase agreement with Becker Chapman post number 138 of the American Legion approved on April 6, 2015 to authorize a $50,000 incentive payment with the remaining incentive of up to $50,000 to be paid upon substantial completion of the project.
Second.
Okay. Council, do you have any questions or comments regarding any of those three?
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Lynn.
Is Eric here?
Yes.
Eric is here.
Could yes. Eric, could you give us a quick overview of why we did that incentive payment? I think there was a lot of misinformation last week about what we were doing. Why did we explain why we had some kind of oversight on that last $100,000?
Eric Schrader, city planner. When the city was in the negotiations for acquisition of the American Legion facility, one of their major concerns was getting a fair purchase price for their existing building, but then also enough money that they could either buy and build new or buy an existing facility and renovate it to meet their needs. And as we were going through that process and they were looking at different options, it was becoming pretty evident that the equivalent of, you know, of what they had was going to generally be very fairly expensive, whether they bought a vacant piece of ground and built new or bought an existing building and renovate. Ultimately, they ended up buying an existing building and are in the process of renovating it right now.
But as part of that purchase agreement, we agreed to a purchase price of $300,000 for their existing building, and then agreed to an incentive payment of up to $100,000 based on written documentation of the expenses upon substantial completion of the project. They are well underway on the project. They are not quite substantially complete. They have put a significant amount of money into the property that they have acquired, and they are requesting that this amendment so that they can get $50,000 now so that they can keep moving forward on the renovation project and, you know, can pay their bills essentially. And then the remaining 50 would be available upon substantial completion.
And you're kind of providing oversight for the construction bills and et cetera. Are they going to be okay? Do you think the $400,000 total is going to be enough to do to make a functionally equivalent building to what they had?
The Legion representative last week suggested that it may take a little bit more and that they may have to do some fundraising, but they're in the ballpark. So it depends on a lot of the details on what they pick, but they, you know, based on the amount of work that they've got done and the amount of work that's still to be completed, I don't think they're going to end up being another $100,000 short, for instance. They may have to do some fundraising depending on what all components that they're trying to get included in that renovation.
And on Thursday at 9 o'clock, actually, we had a phone conference with staff in regards to some parts of the agreement, but also Mr. Welper had met the folks there at, 9 o'clock that morning and walked through, took a look at what was taking place, and then also came up with some possible significant savings in regards to having the roof repair as well, and staff had conversations with the general contractor to make sure that this project is going to be one that they can actually get completed and not be taken advantage of from working with multiple people. So I think it was a great example of the ability to come from behind this desk and work with folks to get something done. And like I said, Craig, Michelle, and Eric, and Noel did a great job of making sure that they have a winning situation.
We're trying.
Further comments, Mr. Smith?
Sure. Eric, so kind of going back to square one, $300,000 we gave the American Legion for their previous building, correct?
Correct. That was considered roughly the equivalent of fair market value of that building.
Okay. Or maybe a little bit more than fair market value.
Well, we didn't have it appraised. We went off of the, I believe it was 120% of assessed value, which when we've looked at where appraisals come in compared to assessed value, that's usually in that 110 to 120%. So we thought the $300,000 was a reasonably fair assessment of fair market value without actually having, you know, spending a couple thousand extra dollars on an appraisal.
Okay. And then, and I know we're going to talk about the roof a little later in the agenda, but and I asked this question last week, and I don't know that it's necessarily for you, but this whole issue about this roof, I mean, shouldn't that be somebody's responsibility other than the Legion's? I mean, shouldn't that have been discovered, or was it discovered and was adequately addressed from a monetary standpoint in their purchase, or do you know that?
I don't really know details. I can certainly let the Legion speak on that. From what I understand, when they entered into a purchase agreement on this property before they closed and took possession, they did have the property inspected. As a result of that inspection, there were issues raised, including the condition of the roof. As I understand it, there was some back and forth negotiations, and the purchase price lowered some to reflect that. I don't have details on the amounts. I think, you know, it was probably being sold with a original asking price that probably took into consideration that, you know, the roof may have been nearing the end of its life cycle anyway. So, I mean, as I understand it, there was some negotiation in decrease in that purchase price specifically because of the roof. I don't know the details on the amount.
Thank you. Thanks, Mr. Mayor. Mr. Lynn?
One other question. I thought we had an appraisal. That, remember, we had an appraisal, and it was kind of low, so we kind of threw it out. Didn't we have an appraisal on that, the old building?
I forget now.
No.
Or was that the KWWL?
Noel Anderson, Community Planning Development Director. We did have one appraisal done on that, which was lower than the assessed value.
Right.
So one of the concerns of the Legion was that they were being assessed at a different value for that amount, so we went with the assessed value to determine the 120% value.
And what do you remember what that appraisal was? How much?
I do not. Sorry. I'm not up to the top of my head.
But in any case, at $300,000, we were being more than fair in the acquisition price.
The state code talks about 120% as being kind of an acquisition and relocation type cost to use on a value. The reason that we ended up going higher than that with the additional $100,000 is we had been working with the American Legion on two other specific buildings, and there was really a lack of finding available buildings that had both assembly space and bar space for that type of a use. And so we were really they had to retrofit any other building. Working with two different buildings, the contractors, the costs were coming in at about $400,000. So that was what we thought, that was a fair price. At the same time, we wanted to ensure at council's concerns that they definitely spent money like that, invested back into the Waterloo community. So that was why it was broken apart into the $300,000 and the $100,000 amounts.
Sure. Thanks.
Mr. Just one final.
Mr. Schmidt.
My understanding is correct that the Legion is, they're supportive of this, correct?
Yes, they have signed this agreement.
Thank you.
Mr. Holtman, would you like to make a statement?
Yes.
I would like to get to the microphone, please.
Council,
Curly, wait till you get to the microphone or nobody can hear you.
Sorry.
Come on up.
Evan Holtman, the volunteer counsel for the Legion. In response to your question, Representative Councilman Schmidt, we agreed, and it's interesting what has happened since. We agreed for additional money of $6,000 for the reasons that you've indicated, and it was for the roof. Interestingly, after all of the various gyrations that we've gone through, and I thank Councilman Ron Welper for his assistance, we got three propositions with reference to the roof, and interestingly, the one that the committee agreed to on Thursday night came out to just a few dollars difference in $6,000. So evidently, our negotiations had a fairly good analysis of what the cost was going to be, and that was additional money, as you know, under those kind of circumstances that we would be entitled to, and we were. To bring it up to date, as I indicated, there's two issues, and we've kicked the first one around, and as a part of the motion, we need the $50,000. When I say we, the Legion needs at this point, there are three parts to this structure that we purchased, and it was way under what all the other alternatives were in response to the earlier discussion. I mean, the cost of the building on out 4th Street was going to be tens of thousands more money, which we needed a lot of repair, and we didn't think was a good idea at all. With this project, there are three parts to it, if I can just explain. One part of it is all done. It opened today for sales, and that's the bar section, and it's also a small meeting space for the Legion, or for any other groups that may rent the Legion. The second part is the large part, which is where the bingo exercise is held. And that's within, I would say, from their estimates to me, a matter of 3 or 4 weeks, and it's going to be finished. And not substantial work left to do. Very, very little work yet to do. The third part of the project is the part that the balance of this money primarily is needed for and going to go for, and that's the kitchen, because we have to start from scratch, and it is clean now, ready for the bids to come in for that kitchen project. In order to, with that, then that kitchen project will serve both the bar room and the meeting hall, the big area for bingo, et cetera, et cetera. So literally, they are almost two-thirds of the way home. They're almost done for project. They are done, literally, with Project 1. It opened today. Project 2, they're a short distance from being finished. And Project 3 is going to start from scratch now, which is the kitchen. And that's the reason for the balance beyond the 50. That's primarily what that 50 is going to go toward. Personally, just as a personal observation, and I think it reflects what the Legionnaire leadership has indicated, it is not going to cover our total finality, but we're going to be close, and with some help, as the Legion has had in the past, by volunteer Legionnaires and the public, we see that we're going to have the project completed within probably the next 60 days. Now, I hope that answers some of the questions that came up in your discussion. If there are any others, the Legion leadership is here to answer them, other than me give any legal advices I have given to them along the way.
Thank you, General.
And we thank the council and you, the mayor, for the role that you've played, and that we've had a very difficult situation for everybody. But the goal, and I lived through it, and none of you are old enough to live through it, but we had a station here with the call letters WMT. And that was the Waterloo Morning Tribune. Mm-hmm. It was the morning newspaper back in the 20s and the 30s when newspapers were morning in major cities and afternoon. Now, we still have the Courier, thank God, the afternoon. And we lost WMT to some place called Cedar Rapids. And we were kind of indirectly faced with a similar situation here, with maybe a good share of their leadership and their staff and the money coming into our community going to leave. And we didn't want to see that happen. So we made concessions both ways in the process in order to save.
General, thank you very much. And you said that very well, better thank than you. I could. And your efforts to help save that business are very much appreciated.
If you have any other further questions, I say the leadership is here.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Bill Kemeyer, 526 Home Park Boulevard, Waterloo, Iowa. I'd just like to make a couple comments. I appreciate what the city's doing for these people. Also, I don't happen to be a member of them at this particular point, but I am involved indirectly. I'd just like to make a suggestion. I'd like to have everybody read the Courier yesterday and on their opinion, staff opinion. There's a nice article about that. And I think, you look at the VFW and they're down there in a small building. We've lost the M that's out here because they couldn't afford their building. And the American Legion is trying to keep a veterans organization in Waterloo. Waverly has proved as a community that they're just whaling us when it comes to veterans. And we've got 18,000 veterans, something like that, in Blackhawk County here. And as a city, as a community here, we're really not doing too much to take care of our veterans, to take care of them. Now, we got the museum and all that stuff, but I'm talking about physically taking care of them. And I think their article in the paper yesterday was right on. And I think we've sold enough property around this town to some people that are pretty wealthy, that's got money, that they, without the American Legion going out and having to beg them for some money to get them through this thing and get a facility that will satisfy veterans, that they ought to step forward and say, we're going to handle this. I think the city has done a fair job of giving a decent price for the building, giving them a decent price to remodel that. And now I think it is time, without them having to go out and beg for it, that some of these people that have been reaping the benefits from our city for a dollar ought to go out there and put their money where their mouth is and show us that they do really, in fact, support veterans here. And let's make that as first-class facility as we can for what it is. And I just, again, like I said, I'm thanking the city. I thank you, Mr. Welford, for getting involved and doing what you do. But I think maybe we ought to be looking for some outside help now without having to beg for it. That's my point.
Thanks, Mr. Kammer.
David Dreyer, 3145 West 4th Street. My big question, when I bought private property, is that if there is a certain amount of deterioration or whatever that shows up after you purchase the property, that you have a, the seller has a responsibility. So I guess, I don't know how much that's been checked into, but the roof leaking now, after there was a disclaimer possibly on the sale and whatever they agreed to do or whatever, there's still a certain responsibility in my estimation on the seller's responsibility. I also have a $100 bill here that I'll give to Curly that starts a campaign to raise the money. Waverly raised $3 million to build a new facility. Waterloo can't do the same on private donations. Come on, let's go.
That would be, that's great, Mr. Dreyer. Thank you very much. That's a great, that's, and you know, that's the way our fund for our body cameras got started back several months ago when our good friend Don Miller stepped up and gave us a check, and it just kind of exploded after that. So hopefully that very generous contribution to Mr. Dreyer to the Veterans Building will start a response from the city. Anybody else on any of those three, 10, 11, or 12? Madam Clerk, it's a roll call vote, please.
Mr.
Yes.
Clerk?
Ms. Cole?
Yes.
Mr. Jones?
Yes.
Mr. Schmidt?
Yes.
Mr. Lynn?
Yes.
Mr. Morrissey?
Yes.
Mr. Wilper?
Yes.
Very good. The motion carries. 13 and 14, please.
Mr. Mayor.
Ms. Cole?
I move we adopt a resolution approving a memorandum of agreement with the Grout Museum District, complying with oversight requirements for the cultural and scientific facilities levy to be placed on the November 3rd, 2015 ballot. 14 is a resolution approving award of contract to Carpenter Uniform of Des Moines for the purchase of level 2 body armor replacements.
Second.
Council, any questions on either of those two, 13 or 14?
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Lynn.
Mr. Zellifer, is the memorandum of agreement, is that a legal contract?
Well, Dave Zellifer, city attorney, yes, it certainly would be construed as that. If it's passed by council.
Thank you.
Further comments? Roll call vote, Madam Clerk, please.
Ms. Cole?
Yes.
Mr. Jones?
Yes.
Mr. Schmidt?
Yes.
Mr. Lynn?
Yes.
Mr. Morrissey?
Yes.
Mr. Wilper?
Yes.
Mr. Hart?
Yes.
We get those motions carry. We're going to do ordinances now. We have a couple of those. Please, item 15.
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Hart.
Move to receive, file, and consider and pass for the third time and adopt an ordinance amending number 5079 as amended City of Waterloo zoning ordinance by amending the official zoning map referred to in section 10-4-4, approving a rezone of certain property. And that's a request by Lost Island Real Estate, LLC, to rezone approximately 2.58 acres of land from CP Plan Commercial District to R4 RP Plan Multiple Residence District, generally located near the northwest corner of East Charlotte Road in Hess.
Second.
Council, do you have any questions regarding 15? Madam Clerk.
Mr. Jones?
Yes.
Mr. Schmidt?
Yes.
Mr. Lynn?
Yes.
Mr. Morrissey?
Yes.
Mr. Wilper?
Yes.
Mr. Hart?
Yes.
Ms. Cole?
Yes.
Very good. The motion carries. 16, please.
Mr.
Schmidt.
Item 16 is a motion, to receive, file and consider and pass for the second time an ordinance amending the 2008 traffic code by adding subsection 75A West 5th Street and Baltimore Street, full actuated push button pedestrian section 540 obedience to official traffic control devices, signalized intersections.
Second.
Very good. Council, do you have any questions or comments regarding 16?
Mr. Mayor.
Yes, sir.
Sandy, did the school get back to you about that portable stop sign in the middle of the street?
Sandy Grieco, Superintendent of Traffic Operations. We have been emailing back and forth, and they are having their back-to-school meeting Thursday night. And they are going to discuss with the parents that stop sign will probably no longer be there, that we are going to move it temporarily down to Baltimore until the signals are activated. And they will put their crossing guard down there. So we're trying to move students to Locust in West 5th and Baltimore in West 5th and not go across Western.
That's a great idea.
Further? Madam Clerk?
Mr. Schmidt?
Yes.
Mr. Lind?
Yes.
Mr. Morrissey?
Yes.
Mr. Welper?
Yes.
Mr. Hart?
Yes.
Ms. Cole?
Yes.
Mr. Jones?
Yes.
Very good. The motion carries.
Mr. Mayor, I make a motion to suspend the rules.
Second.
Madam Clerk?
Mr. Lind?
No.
Mr. Morrissey?
Yes.
Mr. Welper?
Yes.
Mr. Hart?
Yes.
Ms. Cole?
Yes.
Mr. Jones?
Yes.
Mr. Schmidt?
No.
Motion fails. We'll take it up for the third reading next month. Next month. Next week. I'm sorry.
It will be next month.
Check it will next be next month. Month. You're right.
No meeting.
And there is no meeting. Well, thank you for that, too. By the way, there's no meeting next Monday for all of those that regularly follow this body. It's the fifth Monday of the month. We don't have a meeting on the fifth Monday. Let's do
Mr. Mayor.
As many as you want.
Just for clarification, there is no 18 because they've withdrawn that, so that one's canceled.
Oh, that's
so
correct.
So 17 is just a motion. 19 is actually a resolution, so it'll take
okay.
a roll call.
Okay, so 18 has been canceled. 17, we need to read. Mr. Hart?
Mr. Mayor, I move to approve change order number 4 for a net increase of $34,149 for the FY 2014 Street Reconstruction Program contract number 859 and authorize mayor and city clerk to execute said document.
Second. Very good. Council, questions on that? Item 17, Mr. Schmidt.
Could we just have an overview
sure.
on what the cause of the increase was?
Eric, you talked to me about it today, but I'm going to let you explain it.
Eric Thorsinger, actually, Councilman Schmidt, this relates to item number 11. This is to extend the sanitary sewer on Fisher Drive that we're getting a permit for in number 11. We currently only have two local contracts. We have a sewer contractor working for us, and this was the contract that we could add that on to and get it done very quickly so we can get out of the way of the development. And it's the Green Acres Storage Building development. And
okay.
we will save significant money by doing it now instead of waiting until sometime in the future. Then we'd have to go through their driveways and landscaping and such, and there'd be a lot of restoration costs.
Thanks.
Further? Madam Clerk?
That was a motion.
I'm sorry. All in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed, same sign. Motion carries. Item 18, please.
19. Mr. Mayor.
And item 19. 18 is canceled.
Mr. Mayor.
Yes, sir.
Move to adopt a resolution approving preliminary construction of sidewalk improvements, and that's for in conjunction with the FY 2016 sidewalk inspection and repair program zone number 5.
Second.
Very good. Thank you, Mr. Hart. Council, do you have any questions regarding this item? Madam Clerk, please.
Mr. Morrissey?
Yes.
Mr. Welper?
Yes.
Mr. Hart?
Yes.
Ms. Cole?
Yes.
Mr. Jones?
Yes.
Mr. Schmidt?
Yes.
Mr. Lynn?
Yes.
Motion carries.
Mr. Mayor, I move to adopt a resolution fixing value of lots.
Second.
Madam Clerk?
Mr. Welper?
Yes.
Mr. Hart?
Yes.
Ms. Cole?
Yes.
Mr. Jones?
Yes.
Mr. Schmidt?
Yes.
Mr. Lynn?
Yes.
Mr. Morrissey?
Yes.
That motion carries.
Mr. Mayor, I move to adopt a resolution adopting preliminary plat and schedule of assessments of costs.
Second.
Madam Clerk.
Mr. Hart?
Yes.
Ms. Cole?
Yes.
Mr. Jones?
Yes.
Mr. Schmidt?
Yes.
Mr. Lind?
Yes.
Mr. Morrissey?
Yes.
Mr. Welper?
Yes.
Motion carries.
Mr. Mayor, I move to adopt a resolution deeming the project necessary and setting date of public hearing as September 8, 2015.
Second.
Finally, Madam Clerk, please.
Ms. Cole?
Yes.
Mr. Jones?
Yes.
Mr. Schmidt?
Yes.
Mr. Lind?
Yes.
Mr. Morrissey?
Yes.
Mr. Welper?
Yes.
Mr. Hart?
Yes.
Very good. The motion carries. Item 20, please.
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Morrissey.
I'd like to make a motion approving change order number 1 to Aspro Incorporated of Waterloo, Iowa to remove the cost of seeding and mulching and to reduce the price of pavement markings changing from thermoplastic markings to surface painted markings for the Taxiway Alpha Rehabilitation Project at Waterloo Regional Airport, reducing the overall cost of the project from $861,208.50 to $847,076.50, a reduction of $14,132.
Second.
Council, do you have any questions regarding item 20?
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Welton.
I've been saying for years how I am against all the painting that we're doing on our streets. I'm really supportive of this thermoplastic marking. I don't know what kind of savings we have here, but I'm probably going to vote against this simply because of that.
Okay. Further comments? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same
aye.
Sign.
Aye.
Very good. Thank you. The motion does carry.
Ladies and gentlemen, that's the end of our regularly scheduled business tonight, so it is time for oral presentations. If there's anyone in the council or in the chambers that would like to speak to the mayor and council, it's time to do so. Please start with your name and address, and please limit your comments to 3 minutes.
1829 West 7th. Last week I was here, but I was going to find out, but I never got a chance to call because I had family come in from out east and down south. I don't think I'm going to die or what, but they all came. So I never had a chance to call. Mr. Hart, did you find out anything on that? What percentage of our employees live outside of Waterloo? Did anybody find anything on that?
Mr. Mayor.
Yes, sir. Mr. Lynn.
Susie sent us an email with mm-hmm. those numbers. Mm-hmm. Should I
please give you those numbers? If you remember what they are.
Yes, yeah. They were overall 70% live in Waterloo.
Are you sure?
That's by yes. zip code, Jerry?
By zip code.
Yeah, we have a difficult time finding everybody's address, but we can cue the zip codes. And
well, that's higher than I anticipated because we're almost a broke city. Where's the money gone? That's just like this thing you're going to vote on, this tax increase. You know, why should I vote for that? If you handled your money properly, you'd have the money. You wouldn't have to do that. But the next thing I want to get into is you go down to the fitness center in Waterloo. I think it's called Planet Fitness. You got idiots that go through there about 100 miles an hour, highly exaggerated. There's no crosswalk for anybody there. Now, somebody's going to get hit because of no crosswalk. I think VGM might be the owner of that, if I'm correct. And hopefully, are you guys owner of fitness? No, you're not? I'm glad to find that out. But anyway, somebody should ask for a crosswalk there.
Jerry, I don't know where you're talking about.
The fitness center, the Planet Fitness Center. There's one in Waterloo.
Okay, well, I'll check that out. I don't know who owns it or what crosswalk there is that you're speaking of, but I'll check that out.
Okay, because otherwise I will lead a discovery if somebody gets hit there.
Okay.
I don't know how to do discoveries, but I know people who do. The next thing I'd like to bring up, and the only reason I'm bringing this up, I see NBC and KWWL, they're all promoting Jim Cramer, and they're promoting another guy. Well, one of the people that was in my house is a financial analyst of companies, and he said, you know, I would like to have these with what Jim Stewart did when he was our common people protector, and you won't believe what he caught Cramer and these Wall Street people in. I'd like to have somebody pass it around to the council people. I think it'll shock me. And that was my last thing I had, so therefore I got done what I wanted to get done, but not quite.
Okay.
You
thanks,
have a
good Jerry.
Day.
Appreciate it.
Mayor, Council, my name is David Goodson, 226 Camel Avenue. I'm here today with a group of people to express our disappointment and outrage of the arrest of Marvin Spencer for interference with official acts. And I'm going to be very brief because in a minute, one of our spokespersons, Reverend Dr. Michael D. Blackwell, will express those sentiments to you. We also have another level of disappointment, and that is, while we know Mayor Clark last week, you were on vacation, mm-hmm. and Chief Trelka, you were in depositions, and I say a level of disappointment because there's a group of us who feel we have a professional working relationship with the two of you. And we came by your offices twice, again, knowing vacation, depositions, and several made phone calls about this issue and have yet to receive any return calls. So I say we have a level of disappointment at that because we thought we had at least a professional relationship that warranted a professional courtesy response call. And finally, this is difficult and disappointing because it seems like such an easy fix. Marvin Spencer arrested for interference with official act. The relationship that a bogus charge, let me add, and the relationship that he has with the mayor and with the chief, just to express, I was called in, chief, with a meeting with you, Marvin Spencer. You two called myself and Minister Michael Muhammad in to help to resolve a situation that you had identified, which gave you a lot of stock in our community. I sat with the Department of Justice about a month or two ago, and I said to the Department of Justice, if there's going to be any significant change in law enforcement in Waterloo, Iowa, Chief Troika is our best bet. So maybe we'll have to talk later. I still have hope in that. I'm going to reserve some hope in that.
Thanks, David.
But stock is low.
So I agree with you that we have a good professional working relationship, and you're absolutely correct that we have met and we have talked about situations, and I hope we can continue to do that.
Okay, so at this time, Reverend Dr. Michael D. Blackwell will express our disappointment and outrage.
I'm Michael Blackwell, and I reside at 5125 Millennium Drive in Cedar Falls, actually. But as many of you know, I have been working in the community of Waterloo for quite some time. And this is our statement. A respected member of the African American community was unduly arrested for interference with official acts. Marvin Spencer has worked indefatigably within the criminal justice system to improve public safety, to demonstrate the overt and subtle racial insensitivity and discrimination within that system, and to help juveniles and adults to become well-adjusted citizens. There are many in the police force, including Chief Dan Troika, who have praised Marvin publicly and shown their respect for him by asking his assistance as a fellow peace officer. Marvin had obliged them. But early Sunday morning, the 9th of August, was no different. Marvin assisted in helping disperse the crowd at the homecoming after party at their behest. It is wholly ironic that a person solicited for assistance innumerable times, including that particular night, could be eventually charged 2 days later with interference with official acts and be humiliated at his job by being arrested in front of co-workers. This action of Marvin's arrest smacks of collusion in the highest order and should not stand. As a matter of fact, we feel that it should be dismissed and Mr. Spencer be given an apology at the very least for defamation of character. If a respected black man who has mattered in our metropolitan area can be treated in such a manner, it is no wonder that Waterloo and the state of Iowa shamefully ranks among the top three places in the nation where disproportionate incarceration of African American males is at its highest. In addition, we advocate for city government
to institute an independent investigator outside of the police department to gather the facts of an incident, possess subpoena power, and make recommendations to the police department and city officials so that community police relations can improve, rogue officers disciplined, and transparency in law enforcement become routine. We need intervention into a system that is indisputably racist, culturally incompetent, virtually lily white, and arrogant enough to believe it can continue to ignore the legitimate concerns of the city's black residents. And that ends my statement, but I would like those who are in consensus with this statement, who are here today, to please stand so that you will have a visible impression of who's concerned.
Thank you, Dr. Blackwell. Eloquent words, as always, and I'm sure you recognize the fact that at this point I can't comment on the situation as it stands now. But rest assured that Director Trelka and I are looking into this, investigating this, to determine whether or not, in fact, there are inconsistencies in this arrest. We have a good relationship, and I feel like that this administration has strengthened that relationship and built upon that relationship with our meetings and our conversations that we have had, you have my commitment that we will continue to do that.
Okay, and I hope that you will also attend to the other issues because of interference with official acts. We have had conversations about that.
Yes, we have.
And it's being used. And also, something needs to be different from the way things have been happening, okay, as business as usual. We need to break into that, to intervene into that system so that we will be able to really make some constructive changes. And that is my hope as well.
Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Donald Page, 5493 Summerland Drive. I've got a few items I want to bring up. One of them, first of all, I want to thank you, Mayor Clark, for during your watch, a lot of positive things and good things have happened to Waterloo. I want to thank you personally for
that. Thank you, Don. Thank you very much.
Several things come to mind. In fact, now just after Mr. Blackwell spoke here, I think it's important that it should go on record that parents should be responsible for the actions of their children. They should be responsible. If you check this, the country of, got it in my mind but can't put it out, in South America, Costa Rica, it's mandatory that children go to school, and if they don't, why, parents can be held responsible for that. I think it should be brought out that parents should be responsible for the finances of their children, whether that parent is living with or without or not with that child. They should be responsible for the financial upbringing of that child instead of putting it on to the state or the county or other stuff. They should be responsible. Should be brought up, that's the parent responsibility of education, that they go to school, and it's the parent's responsibility to provide financial for them also. Several things I want to hit on. One of them, first of all, is the Shawless Road. I had a discussion before Mayor McKinley passed on, and he was very concerned about Shawless Road and local option tax money putting it in. After there were some changes in our option tax, then some local option money was able to put that road in. I think I see now it was a positive mood and a move, and I think Mayor would be proud of that road now. That was a good decision made. I went to took a group to the John Deere Museum, and it's a very, very nice facility. I've been through it, and parts of it reminded me when I started with Deere's in 1949, which is a while ago. And I think that's a very great asset for the city to have that here. And it should bring a lot of people in. I've also lined up a group from Montana that'll be coming to it next next summer in here. So that's a great asset for the community. There's a lot of good things happening in Waterloo, positive things happening in Waterloo. One concern I had is that there was a blurb in the Courier a while back about possibly selling South Hills Golf Course. I was very concerned with that. Waterloo is moving to the south a lot. You have a lot of everything going that way. And the golf courses in Waterloo are a great selling point. So I'm talking about golf courses now. I get another 3 minutes.
No, you don't. No, I need you to wrap it up pretty quick. I try to keep the time.
Well, you get what you can. You negotiate a little bit, you know. Yeah. So anyway, I would be vehemently opposed to any selling of the golf course because if a person buys it, they may buy it to make it money, and let's have our reasonable golf course in Waterloo.
Thanks, Don.
The council and everybody for their time.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Good evening.
Good evening, Bruce.
Bruce W. Kazzer, 514 East 2nd Street, Waterloo. I've got a red flag that popped up in my thinking back when we approved the trail request. First one for Reverend Abraham Funches in court. Okay, when Councilman Lynn questioned about the amount of expense for the trip, and Reverend Francis's on a mission, he said there must be a second set of books to give the implication there's a second set of books because of the discrepancy between the amount left over and the compared to the expenses for this trip for the rest of the year. So can anybody explain that to me, please? It seems to me there's like two set of books.
No, that's not what he was meaning, and Mr. Funches can step up if he needs. But the document that he was referring to, it tells how much budget is left in that line item, and I think what he was meaning is there's other line items that have funds in it. It was just what Mr. Lind was referring to is how much was in that specific line item activity of the fund. So it wasn't that there's another set of books, it's just that there's other funds available that just weren't on that document because it was only referring to that activity.
Yes. Thank you for letting me speak my piece.
Okay. Thank you, Bruce.
David Dreyer, 3145 West 4th Street. In the paper, I have seen that Main Street wants to seek more funding. 20% increase is a pretty good jump. Many of the things that I read about this, and putting up flowers and removal of flowers, holiday decoration, etc., are a lot of times administrated by those people with volunteer help. So I guess I want more explanation on what they want more money for, because many of that is... sometimes I would say probably tied to a TIF promotion or the city workers are out there with a bucket truck or something putting up decorations, which we already pay for. The water rate tax increase or water rate increase, which is a tax in essence of 7%, they want 20, so that's 27 now we're talking about. And I realize the dollars aren't real high. But at the same time, when you're talking all of the different things that keep tacking on, you're talking major money for a lot of the people that are on fixed incomes. I'm on a fixed income, but I think I can handle it as long as I tap into my investments and the market doesn't look good today. Expand the system to handling economic development growth. I don't think we need to continue to expand the TIF, which to me is part of that economic development growth. Some of these areas that we keep expanding into, yes, things are moving this way, but we want to keep bringing them back downtown. So fill in some of those properties that we are avoiding to take them south. You know, it just doesn't make any sense to me. The statement was made, pennies on a daily basis for residential customers for the water increase. I figured that out. It's $13 a month. The Grout Museum wants $15 a month. Is that right? Or whatever, 21, whatever that figure was. Industrial water users are going to seem to have a lower rate possibly, or a consistent rate. We've taken their rate from, let's see, customer is $23 minimum, so they've taken that to $24 for a quarter, but they've taken the minimum for a commercial division to a minimum of $9. That's a dollar more than the minimum for the residential used to be, but yet at the same time, if we want to continue to grow the water plant funds, then why not leave it where it was and let that shake out where it does?
Thanks, David.
I need to come back one more time.
No, Jerry, I'm sorry. I'm really trying to stay by the rules that the council set. Is there anyone else that hasn't spoken? Yes, sir. Just step to the microphone, please.
Dixon Stolke, 421 Belmont Avenue. Is that good?
Perfect. Thanks, Dixon.
All right. So, in the name of economic prosperity, we should make visits to Waterloo as pleasant as possible. When I'm visiting elsewhere, I kind of think whether I'd like to come back there. Sometimes I read the local papers, you know, see how they live, see what they're doing there. Sometimes imagine what I might be doing if I lived there too, maybe working at one of the local companies or running one. Maybe I'd be retired by now out there. I remember reading one of these papers a while back, and the police log was full of stuff like officers retrieving kids' bikes off lawns for safekeeping. When I read the paper here at home, sometimes I imagine like I'm a visitor here. I wonder, would I like to come back here? Given two or three choices, would I accept a job offer here? Maybe move my business in here? Here lately, our paper's been full of stuff about people getting shot at and people getting shot up. We got bullets flying all directions. All kinds of bullets flying all directions, all across town. We got all kinds of kids seeing friends and family killed or imprisoned. We even got a tiny little one randomly gut shot right in the safety of his own home. We got to get a grip on this. We got to get our heads together, find what's going to work right here in our community. Bring in the funding and get this gone. Even after this fear of being shot down in the safety of your own home has been vanquished and lifted away, this action will still promote economic well-being in our community.
Dixon, thank you very much. Very heartfelt words and right on spot.
I do only do it once, is that right?
Yeah, that's right, Don. I'm sorry.
I just wanted to say, who's going to pull the wagon if everybody wants to ride?
Okay, thanks, Don.
Forrest Dillavoo, 1725 Huntington Road. I see in the Wonder Bread agreement, development agreement that we gave those folks 15 years, and VGM was only given 10 years. VGM stated when they made the agreement with you folks that if anybody else got a better deal, that they wanted the same deal. So as legal counsel looked into the fact, can they come back now and ask for 15 years on their deal? Or are we just going to give them 15 years? Has it been looked into legally?
No.
So we could be in court asking for another 5 years, or?
I don't think that that's going to happen for us, but.
Could you put that on a piece of paper and sign it, sir? Thank you.
Jim Chapman, 224 Birch. This problem with Mr. Spencer, I don't know him, but I think the quicker that we get body cams or cameras on the officers, I think a lot of our problems will be more visible and we can get them resolved. I remember in the 50s, I walked this whole town. I was here, I walked from the east side to the west side and went to East High. Never had a problem. Today, you don't go out after dark. So we got a big problem. So I think the body cams will solve a lot of our problems.
Thanks, Jim. Yep.
Bill Kammeyer, 526 Owen Park Boulevard, Waterloo, Iowa. I just want to clarify a couple points here, make sure that I understand what happened here tonight is right. Number one, you really don't have any authority over whether Grout Museum can put this on the ballot for a vote, correct? That's out of your jurisdiction. They have the right to do that without anything from you people, right?
It's a formality, Bill, that the city council approves that, but it is a formality. We have to approve it.
Is that correct, Mr. Attorney? I thought that they had. That is correct. So you have the option of saying they can or can't put it on the ballot. Is that what you're telling me?
In effect, we have the right to say yes or no. I'm quite sure if we would have said no, there would have been a huge backlash, because it is a formality. It's a requirement that that be taken to the city council and voted on, but it is a formality.
Right.
Susie, can you help?
Yes, what council is actually voting on is whether they met the requirements to put it on the ballot.
Right.
Not whether or not it can go on the ballot. So by council voting yes, what they were saying is yes, the Grout did what they were supposed to do, which was get the signatures on the petition. And they did that, so
they
the council
followed the
needed
formality
to forward it to the ballot.
Right.
Thank you. That
so
was better said.
My point is, what I want to get across is it's not you people, meaning the city, asking for a tax increase. You're not asking for that. They are. And I just want to make sure the public understands that. The second thing is, there's no sunset clause on what they're asking for. They're asking for 27 cents or whatever it is, but there's no end to that. So they stated that things have changed in the last 5 years. Things could change in the next 5 years. And my point is, they're asking for an increase of taxes from the taxpayers, and that could go on forever. It's what they're asking for, right? Am
yes.
I understanding that right?
Yes.
So people have to understand that we're going to pay $600,000 a year, whatever that figure is, based on today. It's going to amount to about $600,000, but 5 years from now, that could be $118,000, right? I mean, it could go up dramatically. So people just better understand what they're voting for. Now, I'm not opposed to Kraut Museum, but I think we're giving them a blank check without any checks. And I think people ought to be aware of what they're saying and what they're doing when they go to vote. And that's my only point here, that I want the public to be perfectly clear that the city isn't really doing this. They're just overseeing the formality, like you stated, that they can do what they're doing by putting it on the ballot. But this could really come back to haunt us down the road as taxes go up. And I just want to make that perfectly clear that you're not involved in that process.
Thanks, Bill.
Mr. Mayor, motion to resume.
Yes, sir.
If I could, if nobody else got anything to bring up. I just wonder, and I've mentioned this in the past, but when we've got a five Monday month like this, what would be the likelihood of having like a current up-to-date budget review by department. I don't know that that would take a lot of time to put together, but I guess I've got two thoughts. One is the apparent conflict between what Mr. Funchess has in his budget and what the paperwork shows he has in his budget. I'm assuming that's probably a clerical error. But the other question I've got is specific to code enforcement, but I think it could apply to a number of different departments. My understanding is right now we are certified to have 4 code enforcement officers and we only have 2. And I think with four code enforcement officers, I think our court enforcement group has their hands full. And
we have 4.
Yeah,
I'm not sure. We do have 4. We have 2. I thought we've, I believe 2 have moved to other positions, and I'm not aware that we've backfilled them.
We have.
Pardon me?
We have 4.
We have 4. Okay, well, that's just the kind of thing I'd like to take a look at. So, when we got a 5 Wednesday month. I'd just like to suggest we take a look at that, because in the private sector, that's something that's done on a regular basis.
Thank you, sir.
Mr. Mayor, motion to receive and file oral comments and adjourn.
Second.
All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. We're adjourned. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.